Now we're going to talk about moments in 3D. We've already kind of done this in 2D, the idea being I'm trying to push a, turn a screw or something like that. If I push here, then the moment is defined as the force times the perpendicular distance, D, between that and the thing that you're making the moment about. Now, in 2D, those are pretty easy to come up with. In 3D, it's considerably harder because if I've got some arbitrary force in my, you know, whatever, what is that? So much as again, some arbitrary force in space pushing on something here that and the force, say, is applied off some random moment arm like this. And here's my force. What parts of this force are perpendicular to what parts of this distance? So I'll have some kind of force with some kind of an I, J, and K component. And then I'll have some kind of a distance vector or radial arm with an I, J, and K component. So how do I determine which moments are perpendicular to which distances and which direction they go? And the way that we do this is dealing with cross products. So we'll start off just by giving that to you. The moment is given about a point O, we'll call this point O, is given by R cross F. Now you notice here I actually drew it like this. It actually doesn't matter where I draw that. We'll talk about that here in a sec. But if I've got a force crossed with, or across the radial arm with some force, that will give me the moment about point O. If you remember when we were talking about the cross product, we talked about the I component, the J component, the K component. So that would be, say, D1, D2, D3. I guess I called this D and I should have called it R. But anyway, along crossed with F1, F2, F3, you saw that the I component of the cross product actually only had to do with the J and K components, so the perpendicular components to I. The J component of a cross product only had to do with the I and K, so those were, again, perpendicular. And then for K, it only had to do with the I and J components, so again, the perpendicular components. So by finding the moment using a cross product, that allows us to pull the perpendicular components of the force and the radial arm that contribute to creating the moment. So the moment for this might be something coming out of the page towards you in a completely cattywampus direction. And so it might not be specifically along the X, Y, or Z axis. It might be coming, you know, out of the page towards you. I don't even know how to draw that. But, you know, it might be going back there and coming out of the page. This is one of those things you just kind of got to be comfortable with about why we're using a cross product again, because it's all about perpendicular distances, perpendicular forces, and the moment is perpendicular to both of those. Now, what's important, and I kind of talked about this already, I'll draw another picture to make it pretty, is that, actually, I'll do something a little bit different. Pretend this is in 3D. Is that helpful? Say I have a force coming along here. Now, I can actually calculate the cross product with this radial arm, with this radial arm, so R1, R2, I could use this one, I could use this one, and in any way that I do that, I'm still going to get, so I'm just kind of pretending that this is coming out of the page towards you, but I'm still going to get a moment arm whether I calculate R1 cross F, R2 cross F, R3 cross F, or R4 cross F. Because basically what's going to happen is that it's going to only pull the components that are perpendicular to R1 F, or R2 and F. This might be a little bit easier actually to see in 3D, but this is called the principle of transmissibility. Okay, so the principle of transmissibility basically says you can use any radial arm that's along the line of axis or along the line of action of F. So in 2D, like I said, in 2D, this might be a little bit easier to see. Say I've got some kind of a point O. All right, so I have a force pushing down here, and let's call this distance, let's call it 10. All right, if this distance here is 10 and this force is, say, 20, no, let me get 36 arbitrarily. Now, the moment caused by this is going to be 36 times 10, or 360. So I can calculate that with a scalar, and if I want to put a direction on it, if I go put my fingers in this direction, curl them down, my thumb's pointing out of the page, so that's 360 in the K direction. Okay, so if I wanted to do this with a dot product, I could define the force as negative 36 in the J hat direction. So again, I'm just kind of using shorthand to call this I hat, J hat, K hat. So negative 36 in the, negative 36 in the J direction. Then I can say the R in this case would be pointing negative 10 in the J direction, in the K, I direction, sorry, I direction, 0 and 0. So if I wanted to find the moment with R1, I could cross I, J, and K. So negative 10, 0, 0, 0, negative 36, 0. So I times 0 minus 36. And again, this is assuming you already know how to do this, because here I explained it once, so you should know it forever, right? Go back and review the videos. J minus J times minus 10. And then, let's see. Oh, wait. I can't do this. Let's try this again. I times 0 minus 0 minus J times 0 minus 0. It's like, why am I going to get the wrong answer? Then plus K times 100. 10 times 36 minus 0, so 360. So my vector formulation, I'm going to get, thank goodness, 360 k hat, which is the same thing that I got doing it in a scalar formulation. All right, so what the principle of transmissibility says is that I don't have to use this radial arm, but that if I wanted to, I could, say, use this radial arm. Because in theory, it's along the line of action of that force. So let's say that I went up this direction 8. Then using the Pythagorean theorem, how could I make this a little bit prettier? Let's call this one 24. Then that makes this a 5, 12, 13 triangle, making this side 26. I saved it. So I'm not going to multiply times 26, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to create another radial arm. So we'll call this one R2. This radial arm goes negative 10 in the I direction, and it would go 24, positive 24, in the J direction, and then 0 for K. Okay, so now look what happens whenever I formulate the cross product. See what literally happens. So I've got negative 10, 24, and 0, 0, negative 36, and 0. So the force itself doesn't change. If I've got in the I hat direction, again, I have 0, times 0, in the j hat direction, I've got 0 times 0. And then in the k hat direction, I've got 360 minus 0. So I still have 360 k hat as my moment. So you see, between this moment here, between this moment here and this moment here, the only difference is in this position I have a 24. But because of the way the cross product works out, that 0, instead of being multiplied by another 0, now it's a 24 times a 0. But in the end, it's all still coming out to be times 0. So basically the idea is, it doesn't matter what r that I pick, I'm still going to get the exact same moment, because whenever I do the cross product, it's only going to take the appropriate contributions from the different, from the perpendicular components. So even if I drew, and you could try this again, just make up a distance here and say, okay, that's still along the line of action. If I create a vector, it's still only going to have a 10 component in the J direct, in the K direct, blah, a 10 component in the I direction, and anything that has in the J direction is just going to end up being multiplied by 0. So I think it's a little easier to see in 2D. And then in your brain, think about how this is going to work in 3D. Okay, so there. The last thing that we want to talk about, not really the last thing, but a couple other things we do want to talk about when we talk about moments in 3D, is that I can get a resultant moment. So that means that if I have something going on here, and I have a bunch of forces going on, these are all going the same direction, they don't really have to. This could be in 3D, whatever. And then I have a bunch of vectors, and again, these vectors don't have to be perpendicular, because I'm just going to cross product them anyway. So R1, R2, and R3, that I can find a resultant moment about 0.0 by just simply adding up the cross products of all the forces going around it. So I could do it this way, or I could find each individual moment and sum them up, and this isn't going to be a very interesting equation, but it's important to know that you can find the resultant moment around a specific point by simply summing up all the contributing moments. So M1 plus M2 plus M3. I'm kind of went off the page there a little bit. All right, but you can find the resultant moment by simply adding up all the existing moments. The last thing that's important to talk about is that you can use a resultant force to find a moment. If they're all coming out of the same place, so this is finding forces, all these forces are initiating in various places, and we're going from there. But say I had, you know, several forces coming out here. About some point O. If I wanted to find out the moment about point O, I could add, say if this is F1. F2 and F3 about a radial, some R. I could go in here and I could find whatever the, and assuming this is in 3D, so I can't really draw a pretty picture. I could find the resultant force and cross it and get the same answer. So basically the idea is the moment about O, I could either add up R cross F1 plus R cross F2 plus R cross F3, or I could say that the moment, see if I factor out an R, I would get R cross F1 plus F2 plus F3, and I think you can show this algebraically, you just pull the R out. Or alternatively, you could say that I'm just going to take R and cross it, add it, cross it with the resultant force of those three. So again, assuming that this is equal to F1 plus F2 plus F3. So it's perfectly okay to do that. The reverse is actually also true if you want. If you have a force, and say you were doing this in 2D. Ah, come here. Drop my pen. If you were going to do this in 2D. Ah, come here. Junk. If I had a force that went like this, and I knew this distance and this distance, what I could do is I could, instead of using the resultant, I could actually use the components. So I could use the, I could break it out into Fy and Fx to cross with my Rx and Ry. So I could say that that would be, the moment here would be Rx times Fy, and that's a positive moment. And then minus Fx times Ry, and that's a negative moment. If I wanted to vectorize it, I could say that's in the k-hat direction. So again, this looks like a cross product. So that should definitely be hopeful news to you. But the idea is that you can use this both forward by saying I can take all my forces and use a resultant, or I could say I could take my one force and pretend it's a resultant and just break it into its components and use that to find the moment as well.